Hi, I'm Don Hahn, the producer of Hunchback of Notre Dame.
And I'm Kirk Wise.
And I'm Gary Trousdale.
We're the directors of the Hunchback of Notre Dame.
And for the next 90 minutes, we're going to give you a little backstage tour of the making of the Hunchback of Notre Dame with sordid details and possibly a challenging abdominal workout along the way.
Was that assorted details or sorted?
Sorted details, sorted. I think it was.
Yeah. So.
Very good.
Well, this movie all starts out with Victor Hugo in France and this opening sequence, which was pretty challenging to put together.
This is probably the longest single shot in the film. We actually managed to make our camera and computer department start coughing up blood trying to composite this entire scene.
We were told that the computer could not crash because it could handle so much information, and we crashed it twice, and we're damn proud of it.
We are really proud.
It's probably 50 or 60 levels of artwork you're looking at here as we're
easily sailing
through the city towards Notre Dame. And we went to Notre Dame several times. It's one of those funny movies where you can actually visit the place where it takes place.
Yeah, that was one of the things that was unique about this film, was that we were able to visit Notre Dame and spend a couple of weeks there crawling all over the thing and taking pictures from every possible angle and taking rubbings of the texture of the stone. And it was great. It really gave us a sense of being there, and I think it made our rendition of the cathedral all the more believable.
This whole sequence didn't start out as a song, did it?
No, it did not.
This was
a dance sequence. Number. No.
This whole sequence is a long, boring, talking introduction as to how Claude Frollo, the most powerful man in Paris, would be hitched up with Quasimodo, the misshapen bell ringer.
Yeah, it was always really hard for us to justify what is our villain of the story doing, sort of attached at the hip to our hero of the story. And so this prologue was devised to kind of explain how the two of them came together, their secret origin story.
So we tried a couple versions, just with, you know, dramatically acted out with dialogue. It just didn't work.
It was very dry. It was very talky, and it was very dull. And it was actually Stephen Schwartz who looked at the material and said, "Guys, I think I can
help you here."
Yeah, I can musicalize this. We can turn this into a song. We can get much more information in a much more interesting and dramatic way if we do it through song.
Here comes the bad guy for the first time.
This is the bad guy. You can tell because of his black horse, black hat, black cape.
If you haven't guessed yet, here's the villain.
And voice from the tomb.
This whole
his horse, by the way, his name is it
Snowball.
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 Yes.
Appropriately enough.
Yeah.
This whole sequence was done in our studio in Paris, and it was interesting because they seem to have a real grasp, obviously, about the way medieval Paris looked, because they walk out their front door every day.
Look out the window.
And they see it.
Yeah, there it is. Yeah. Every day. Yeah. They sort of had the home court advantage. Something interesting about Frollo in the sequence, which is very subtle. The sequence takes place 20 years before the actual story begins. And if you look at Claude Frollo's features, and particularly the color of his hair, you'll notice he is 20 years younger.
He's about 15 years.
Yeah.
Younger.
Well, yeah. Well, we say 20 years in the song.
Something like that.
Somebody says 20 years.
Yes, yes, it's 20 years.
This whole sequence was boarded by Paul and Gaetan Brizzi, two Parisian brothers who did a great job of the sense of this locomotive of a horse bearing down on Quasimodo's mom.
There was a lot of discussion as to whether or not you should see Quasimodo's face as a baby, and we opted not to see it because we thought it was more dramatic to reveal it later as he comes out of the shadows and we see him for the first time. We thought it might be kind of unintentionally humorous to see this little, you know, quasi-baby.
Some great special effects here, too, just snow blowing off the top of the well, and some great computer-generated snowflakes flying through the scene.
Well, that scene with the well was a good combination because there was the hand-drawn effects of it blowing off the well, like you said. But all the snow you see here is particle system snow done in the computer, and even that blowing mist—it's just the—it's the same snowflakes re-exposed, but with a huge blur put on them so that they follow the exact same path that the snowflakes do.
Something interesting you'll see coming up here is if you watch the statue of Mary, when the lightning flashes, her eyes snap open.
So now it's no longer our little secret.
Yes, it chills Claude Frollo to the bone, but if you look closely, you'll see it happen. We thought it was kind of eerie and cool, but no one noticed but us.
Okay, don't blink. Here it comes.
Yeah.
Here it comes.
Ah!
Oh, there it is.
That was scary.
That was,
yeah,
that was
it got me. This old musical opening number has a, I think Alan and Stephen were really inspired by the Latin Mass.
Actually, the Requiem Mass by
Mozart.
Mozart, yes.
I remember him.
That's what we played that over an early boarded version that was basically just a dialogue version, and we played the Requiem Mass over it, and Stephen got really excited and said, just a minute, and he ran off and ran back with this.
Beautifully done.
Yeah, it's really one of our favorite sequences in the movie.
Give me 10 minutes, guys.
I love this transition, this little cape coming in, and you're back at the puppet show all of a sudden.
This was also it was decided at this point that we'd make Clopin sort of the narrator of our story, which was kind of very theatrical in nature, and I think really appealed to Stephen Schwartz kind of in a Pippin-esque kind of way to have this performer character be the one who sort of takes you through
a little of that, a little of cabaret.
Yeah.
Here's some big computer-generated bells put in a traditionally painted background with beams of light coming through with light motes and dust in it, and the title comes on, and it's just a beautiful thing.
This movie is a real a hybrid of traditional elements and computer graphics elements. There's fewer standalone computer graphic sequences like there were in Beauty and the Beast, and more an integration of the two. This is the first time we actually see Quasimodo. We've kept him in the shadows all up until this point, kind of building him up as this mysterious monster. And when he actually turns his face into the light, we see that he has a kindly expression and a kind of a gentle manner. And it was important to establish this right away to kind of get the audience on Quasimodo's side.
We did sit in previews when we were previewing the movie, and we always wait for that moment when Quasimodo turns around and the audience would go,
But the audience had this expectation, too, the Hunchback of Notre Dame, that it's going to be a monster. You know, Hollywood's treated Quasimodo as a monster for, you know, the past 70, 80 years.
Mm-hmm.
And so this is our chance to kind of show him, to show the audience that he has a heart. You know, he's not a bad guy.
And it's really a credit to James Baxter, the supervising animator, to have brought that out in Quasimodo's performance. Pretty much from frame one, you see past the kind of misshapen exterior and really see into his heart. So it was a really great job by James.
Here comes our comic characters, Victor, Hugo, and Laverne.
Yeah, these were actually kind of inspired by Victor Hugo, the author. In many passages in the original novel, he implies that two Quasimodo, the gargoyles that are all over the cathedral, are actually alive. He has long conversations with them. They appear to be speaking with him. It didn't seem like a real big leap of faith for us to actually animate them and give them voices and characters.
One early idea for these guys was that they were outcasts. We never really play that in the story that much, but that they were kind of the stonemasons' cast-offs.
Yeah, we...
Since if you go to Notre Dame Cathedral now, you won't find these particular ones there. These are the ones that the sculptor kind of, you know, didn't do as well.
They're for sale in a Disney store, though. Yeah. You can buy them there.
One's got a chipped ear, and the other's got a broken tooth or something like that. This is a Quasimodo's kind of tabletop model of Notre Dame and the city of Paris. This was an idea that was developed by Bernie Mattinson, one of our fine story artists, and it was his idea that Quasimodo would fantasize about the world outside, and his fantasies were expressed through this hobby of making models and carving figurines of the people in Paris, including one of himself.
He could live vicariously through this little wooden figure of himself, because he can never go down himself. This is the only way he can really experience what the city's like, is kind of on this little tabletop city.
The layout guys did an amazing job here trying to create Quasimodo's loft apartment up in the bell tower of Notre Dame, because there's not much up there when you go traveling up into Notre Dame, but they wanted to make it Quasimodo's world, his home.
Yeah, Derek Gogol and Tom Shannon really kind of created the design for the place, and it's a wonderful multi-level loft with wonderful statues and tapestries.
This is a scene, we didn't do it through the whole movie, but we put stains on the gargoyles to make them feel like they've been out in the weather for a long time.
Yeah, that was the job of special effects, where they had a map for each gargoyle, you know, from every angle, so that the stains would appear consistent. They wouldn't seem to kind of crawl around on the surface of the gargoyle. But like Don says, we couldn't put them on every scene just because it was, because it took a long time. And after a while, you just, you know, you don't need it. I'll go. Oh, hurrah. I'll get
There's a fun thing coming up when Frollo comes in. The art direction changes pretty abruptly.
Watch the light. Watch the light. Yeah. Oh.
Frollo walks in the room, and literally all the light is sucked out.
He must have bumped the light switch on the way up the stairs.
It's as though that black cloak of his just absorbs light like a black hole. Yeah. That was a conscious decision by Dave Getz, our talented art director.
Quasimodo's posture changes too, from kind of into kind of a submissive character.
Well, his whole personality, instead of being almost normal, he in outgoing and friendly and articulate, he's really socially stunted.
Exactly,
now.
He becomes very shy and very nervous around Frollo.
One of my favorite things here is the way Frollo sets the table, or Quasimodo sets the table with his cup and Frollo's cup, and kind of the difference between the silverware and things.
You'll see kind of the way the actual cups reflect their characters. Frollo's cup being tall and angular and made out of cold metal, and Quasimodo's being kind of squat and made of this humble wood.
There's Tony J doing a spit take, which was not really Tony J because he didn't know how to do a spit take.
Well, he tried. he did a spit take.
Something they don't teach in the
in the Royal Shakespeare Academy.
Yeah.
Maybe he missed that day. I don't know. The height of Notre Dame is really interesting here. Dave Getz, our art director, was trying to show the height of the cathedral in relationship to the surrounding village.
Yeah, he really exaggerated the scale of the cathedral. It's much larger than it actually is in real life. Just to give you the impression of the cathedral being God's embassy on earth. No matter where you were in the city or even the countryside, you could still see this incredible landmark. If you'll notice in some of these scenes, Frollo's hat is really large. It's like the size of a small lifeboat. And this is because Kathy Zielinski, the very talented animator who created Frollo, constructed the costume for herself in order to film herself and get an idea for how the fabric moved. But the hat that she built was really huge. So in later scenes, you'll see that the hat is considerably smaller.
There's some nice lighting happening throughout this little section. The gobo lighting, we call it, the patterns of light that go over the top of the characters to create a sense of space.
Here it comes.
Coming up right here. This is the first scene animated of Quasimodo by James Baxter. This really went a long ways towards kind of proving to the studio that we could really create empathy for this character.
I mean, Tom's voice certainly goes a ways towards it also.
He's terrific.
Tom Hulse was absolutely amazing. He gave this wonderful, heartfelt, sensitive, kind of boyish but sincere performance to the character, and also had a great singing voice.
But remember, giant hat. No, U.S. Navy printed on side.
That was Mobile in that scene.
Yeah, if you look closely at that last shot, you can see a beautiful animated Mobile.
Dust motes up in the air.
These are the little details that make Disney films great.
Speaking of little details, here comes Frollo.
There's Frollo.
He took the express
elevator down, and there he is in the middle of the square.
Now, a down shot is coming up when we go from the imaginary city to the real city. And if you look closely at that background painting, you'll see a satellite dish in the lower left-hand corner.
This guy was way ahead of his time.
Here it comes. Wait for it. Lower left-hand corner.
There it is.
A little joke for us.
Ha ha.
There's some great layout in this sequence. You know, there's a guy named Ed Gertner, who is the head of our layout group, who is absolutely brilliant at creating scale and the mass of the cathedral and a sense of the camera moving around.
This whole cinematography is I'm going to attribute to Ed.
Yeah. This shot right here was based on a Brenda Chapman storyboard, and it pretty much stayed intact, that concept of Quasimodo silhouetted by the light and moving between the columns.
You know, a few years ago, the three of us made a movie called Beauty and the Beast, and there's Belle right down the square walking by on her way to the bookstore.
Now, on the left there, there's a couple guys holding a pig, which is Pumbaa, and that's the magic carpet from Aladdin with the guy over here on the right, over his arm.
Here's a buttress shot coming up where Quasimodo slides down this buttress. It's all a computer-generated background that slides around in perspective.
You just like saying that, don't you?
I do. Just like saying buttress. But it's a combination of a computer-generated element, the buttress, hand-drawn effects, the water, and a hand-painted background, the city of Paris.
There's a great camera flare at the end of that scene, too, which doesn't happen, of course, in animation. You have to actually draw the camera flare
to make you believe it. Animate a lens flare.
I love this shot.
This is our combination Singing in the Rain King Kong shot, as we refer to it as.
Now, the turning spire there was done by hand. At the time, the computer department was too busy I think they were still working on Pocahontas at the time. And I couldn't spare the time. So
this is all one shot here from the time Quasi slides off the spire. We still haven't
all
cut.
All the way until we introduce Phoebus. This is all one shot, not a single cut.
Another Ed Gertner extravaganza. Birds flying through, highlights in the rose window, smoke coming up from the chimneys.
And the camera drops, the camera cranes down like it would in a live-action film to reveal the entrance of Phoebus.
Here it goes.
Same shot.
All in one shot.
Still haven't cut.
Isn't that something?
Here's Captain Phoebus, animated by the very talented Russ Edmonds.
For this AAA roadmap.
Russ also animated the horse.
He animated the horse for us in Beauty and the Beast. He was the lead animator on Philippe, so he's kind of an expert on horses.
We called Achilles here Philippe's kind of dim-witted cousin.
Here's the first time we see Esmeralda in the show.
Yeah, we wanted her to reveal to be something kind of special, that there'd be kind of a spark between the two of them when they laid eyes on each other.
Boink, there it is.
There's the spark.
That was the spark.
Woohoo!
She's not bad looking. Phoebus is a funny character. He's one of the few Disney handsome leading men that has facial hair.
I'd venture to say he's probably the only hero we've done.
Mm-hmm. Aside from the Beast, of course.
Yeah, well, yeah. Of course, who had the market cornered on facial hair. This is the comedy team of Corey Burton and Bill Fagerbakke as the two dim-witted guards.
There's a guaranteed kid laugh right here coming up. Here it comes.
Ready?
Every preview brought down the house.
It really did, especially we added the big tuba raspberry sound there as well.
Here's an interesting thing. Whenever we recorded Kevin Kline, we gave him a big sword, and somehow it helped him get into the character a little bit more. And even though he would never appear on camera, he always recorded in the studio holding this giant sword.
He was in the studio in front of the microphone swinging the sword around.
And it really
kind of screwed up a few takes because he'd like bonk it into the microphone stand. Or
cut the cable.
But I think he just felt more knightly, feeling the weight of that sword in his hand. So it was Roy Conley
that said, "Guys, he's an actor. Give him a prop."
Here's Esmeralda in disguise over here on the right, which kind of lays some pipe for later in the film when she has to escape out in the city streets in her little jolly disguise.
Now that joke, Achilles' heel, that came up in a recording session with Kevin Kline. We didn't have a name for the horse, and Kevin Kline during the session said, "Guys, what's his name? This horse needs a name." And we tossed around all kinds of different ideas until one of us,
Will.
It was Will or me or
Will
Gary.
Finn.
One of us said, "How about Achilles? That way he can say Achilles' heel." And we all cracked up in the booth, and his name ended up Achilles. Yes, sir. I've always enjoyed this shot here with the torturer, who clearly enjoys his work.
I think that was one of Will Finn's favorite scenes also.
This little scene had to get across the idea of the confident captain in from the battles to do Frollo's bidding for him in town.
And this is the first time that Phoebus kind of realizes that the job he's been hired to do may not be entirely pleasant.
As pleasant as soldiering is, I'm sure, but he sees here that he's kind of signed on with something he hadn't quite counted on.
This whole sequence was to kind of set up the dynamic of the gypsies being oppressed in Paris. It was boarded by
Jim Capobianco. He actually, Jim created the device of Frollo using ants to illustrate his point of view.
His disdain for the gypsies. Dehumanization of the gypsies.
And it's actually very effective. We always got a nice ew from the audience when he smashes them with that big block.
Well, even when he lifts the block up, and they all go crawling around. Right here.
Ew.
Never failed.
It also sets up the Court of Miracles.
Oh.
Frollo's master plan to find the Court of Miracles.
Oh, very clever.
Almost as if we'd planned it that way.
True. And this leads us into probably the biggest production number, not only of this film, but perhaps in animated history. We started three years before the movie came out, and it was finished right up until the day we had to finish the film. And it's a song called Topsy Turvy.
It's a real tour de force, not only for Alan and Steven, who composed this epic song that had to cram a ton of storytelling into a relatively short period of time. But it also shows off our CGI crowds, which were a big technical breakthrough for us.
great group of people led by fill her up. Led by Kiran Joshi, who is the head of our computer graphics area, created these huge Ben-Hur kind of crowds in the streets of Paris, and a lot of this confetti, and just the feeling of a huge crowd scene.
It's really only about six different...
Half a dozen people. Yeah,
about half a dozen computer-generated models with interchangeable hats and hair.
Masks, beards, and then their color palette will change.
Right, and a variety of different types of behaviors. But the way they're dispersed through a crowd scene, it gives you the illusion of this huge multitude.
They're also usually mixed in with the hand-drawn crowd so that your attention isn't right to the computer-generated people. You're supposed to be looking at the two-butted horse or the dancing girls.
We originally thought of the CG characters in the sequence to feel more like a moving wallpaper, but they turned out so well that we used them more often.
Here's a great little scene where we introduce Quasimodo to Esmeralda for the first time in kind of a tender little moment in her tent.
Yeah, we want a little bit of an emotional connection between the two of them before the actual judging of the Feast of Fools contest.
So that she had a little bit of a, you know, as little as this is, a little past with him, so that it wouldn't seem cruel that she pulls him up on stage.
Exploding-headed clowns, based on a drawing by Gary.
Thank you very much.
And then we introduce the villain again in his Frollo-mobile.
The Carriage of Justice, which we also called the Miscarriage of Justice.
The guy that really carries this song is Paul Kandel, who did the voice of Clopin. Man, is he great.
An amazing actor and performer. He was in the Broadway production of Tommy, playing Uncle Ernie.
That's where we picked him up from.
Yeah. Just an amazing vocalist. He really, even Paul's actual physical being influenced the look of the character. If you look at the animation of Clopin, you see a lot of Paul in there.
He often dressed in tights, too, just on the streets.
Which, just in general.
Yeah. This whole scene of Esmeralda's dance had to introduce her as an attractive character, but also had to kind of make Frollo bothered by her appearance. And
in a kind of uncomfortable way.
Well, this sequence here is supposed to affect all three of our leading men. That's Quasimodo, Phoebus, and Frollo.
All three of them have
to be thunderstruck by her.
Yeah, they all fall for the girl at the same time. And so we knew Esmeralda was going to have to be something pretty special, and this dance sequence was going to be pretty amazing.
It's a great animator named Dan Marie Bardwell who animated this whole sequence really with very little live-action reference or choreography reference.
We shot some live-action reference of a dancer for that sequence, but ultimately threw it out because Esmeralda had to do moves and have a kind of timing that you couldn't duplicate in live-action.
This whole idea of crowning a king of fools and the Festival of Fools isn't just a Victor Hugo invention. It actually was an ancient medieval festival.
Yeah.
We tried to recreate that in the streets.
We always saw it as a combination of Mardi Gras, the Super Bowl, Woodstock, and the
World Cup soccer.
The Doodah Parade.
We actually had to get about 200 people on a soundstage to record these colossal crowd
cheers
sounds
and boos and gasps.
They had to be directed like any other actor because they had to react to very specific points during this whole song sequence to what was happening on screen. So we had to tell like a huge group of people, you have to be scared here, you have to be shocked here, now you have to start getting excited, and it has to build here.
Now murmur to yourselves. Now cheer.
Here's one of the interesting experience directing.
This scene here is one of the biggest in Topsy Turvy, actually. A guy named Phil Young, veteran animator.
Spent 3 months on this doing Clopin and Quasi and the crowds. And that was combined.
The guys carrying Quasimodo.
It was combined with CG crowds and CG confetti. This is our first CG crowd shot right there.
Down shot.
That's the one that sold us on the process. Kieran told us it would work, and we kind of believed him, but it was that shot that really sold us.
And when you see shots like this, you're just happy we did it. There's Bill Matthews, a beloved animator around the studio here, jumping into that vat of beer. Here's a scene straight from Victor Hugo.
Watch the art direction here. You'll see a great dramatic light change as the crowd starts to turn against Quasimodo.
We kind of lose the kind of happy party colors. They get a little duller here.
It's almost as though a cloud went over the sun.
And then when Quasimodo gets roped and tied, everything goes red. Do not adjust your sets.
There it goes. These are things we can do in animation that sometimes look a little bit overdone in live action, but for some reason work.
I love that scene of Quasimodo's perspective swinging around the audience and people throwing things at him.
The quasi cam.
Mm-hmm. Big choir chanting over the top of it.
Yeah, we actually assembled like the greatest choir you could possibly imagine. All these
the
great
best
vocalists.
Voices of Europe.
Yeah, all the best voices of Europe assembled in one choir that we recorded in London.
Part of that choir was a boys' choir of about 15 little, 12-year-old boys.
Like eight to 12-year-old boys.
And we thought they would show up, this little cherubic group, but they came in with their backpacks and Walkmans and
backwards baseball caps,
baggy Nintendo.
Shirts, proceeded to sing this really angelic little moment.
I'm sorry. This wasn't supposed to happen.
This is a good showcase for Demi Moore. We really wanted a heroine who would sound a little bit different than the typical clear-voiced Disney heroine. We wanted someone with a slightly rougher quality to her voice that sounded like she'd been around. And Demi had all of those qualities, plus a really nice tenderness and strength, and I think that comes through really well in this whole sequence.
It's also a little tribute to Tony Ficelli, who animated Esmeralda, because he took the voice and took it to new places, made her a terrific character.
This is one of my favorite Esmeralda scenes coming up here.
To me, I like this scene also. It allowed her to be real overly hammy.
It's kind of, it sets us up for a whole sequence that we call The Merry Chase.
It was storyboarded by Kevin Harkey, who is an absolute master at comedy chase scenes. Just an incredible, inventive comic mind.
And a darn good hog collar, too.
And here's where we really get sort of an idea of Esmeralda and Jolly as this great little team, and some terrific animation by Ron Husband, who animated Jolly throughout the whole picture.
I love the sound effects in this sequence because they're very cartoony. You have all those guards backing up with like car crashes and little
airplanes.
Yeah, we've got airplanes, World War II bombers, bowling alley sound effects.
This old heretic is actually the voice of Gary Trousdale, ladies and gentlemen.
So that's me too.
Yep. That is you. Congratulations. There's another great little sound effect coming up when Esmeralda throws the hat.
Tilt.
Little pinball thing happening. We used to debate over what Phoebus should say.
Ay, caramba.
Another lighting change right here, key lighting change.
Cloud goes over the sun.
And here in the soundtrack, you hear this rumble of thunder as Frollo's anger builds.
Turn up those surround speakers, folks.
You notice that Frollo's horse and Phoebus's horse don't like each other.
Yeah.
Seeing this
those of you with the Letterboxd version of this movie will see their expressions more clearly. This we chose to play in pantomime. There used to be a lot of dialogue here, but we just eliminated all the dialogue except for this one line.
It just worked out better that way.
Some fabulous animation of James Baxter coming up. Quasimodo's Walk of Shame back to the cathedral.
More use of the computer-generated crowds you see not only in this shot here, but in the high shot when we cut up to the top angle here.
It's a really nice Alan Menken cue here as well. He took Out There and kind of reorchestrated it in a minor key, and it's kind of like all of Quasimodo's dreams are dashed at this point, so it's really effective.
And we see the inside of the cathedral for the first time, which...
We wanted it to be in real contrast to the wildness of the festival, just be this really serene place.
We have our London choir chanting over the top of this.
Literally is a sanctuary.
We didn't want to do a big scoring cue here, we just wanted it to be peaceful and serene, so we just went with this... chanting until, of course, Phoebus shows up and
wrecks everything.
Easy. I just shaved this morning.
Oh, really? You missed
here. We wanted to get some sort of verbal sparring between the two to show that they were a match, both mentally and physically. It was all kind of our grand scheme to make Phoebus and Esmeralda feel like a couple that belong together.
Kind of a Tracy and Hepburn thing, you might say.
If Tracy and Hepburn fought with
swords
and candelabras.
Yeah, I missed that movie. There's a guaranteed laugh coming up here when Jolly hits him in the stomach every time we previewed it. Right here.
Didn't know you had a kid.
Brought the house
One of the worst puns in human history.
Thank you, ladies and gentlemen.
I'm Phoebus.
That's an interesting thing here. It starts out being kind of a sacred environment with chanting and candlelight, and then the effects animators, in a very subtle way, kind of begin to turn into a more romantic.
Yeah, the light becomes setting. More diffuse. The candles glow.
Just by their placement.
Yeah.
How much light they kick out.
We kind of burn the light out here through the windows to give it a more romantic vibe right before Frollo comes in and ruins everything. We call this Frollo's Interruptus.
Good work, Captain. Yeah, Frollo comes in with a gust of wind that blows out some of the candles.
Minister Frollo learned years ago.
Archdeacon by Dave Burgess.
With David Ogden Stiers.
David Ogden Stiers.
Yes, we first used him way back in Beauty and the Beast as Cogsworth, the mantle clock, and he's since then appeared in Pocahontas and here in the Hunchback of Notre Dame.
That's right. Here's a little scene that was kind of central to the story. It was central to Victor Hugo and something we didn't want to leave out of the film, which was the kind of tension between Esmeralda and Frollo.
Because Frollo secretly, even though he's sworn to capture Esmeralda, there's this part of him that wants her in a romantic sense.
Or at least in a lustful sense.
Yeah, and that was always a real delicate balancing act for us because the acting had to get that across.
It's really hard in animation because you seldom have the actors in the same room. You had Demi Moore, we would find her in Florida or, you know, wherever she was filming. We'd do Tony Jay in Los Angeles, we'd do Kevin Kline in New York, and to try to cut those together and make it sound like a performance is a real tribute to Ellen Kennesche, who was our editor, to try to make all those vocal performances sound like they came out of the same room.
Don't worry, Jolly. If Frollo thinks he can keep
us here,
he's...
Notice that Jolly has an earring. It matches Esmeralda's earring. We thought that would kind of visually make them a team.
It would be unwise to arouse.
They can only afford one set between the two of them.
This leads us into a part of the movie where we actually had another song at one point.
The song that Esmeralda is going to sing here is actually the first song that was written. There was a second song written called "Someday," which was a bigger, more anthematic kind of a feel.
It's the song that's played over the end credits.
Mm-hmm. But ultimately, we decided that this was a moment where Esmeralda is supposed to be humble and kind of appeal to God to help her people, and it's
a little more heartfelt. Yeah, personal.
It was something more personal, so we decided to go with this version, and I think it was the right decision.
Part of the problem of doing a musical is you find out that some of your actors don't sing, or don't sing too well anyway. And in this case, we had to go searching for someone to double Demi Moore as a singing voice.
A
stunt double. And we found the lovely Heidi Mollenhauer.
Yes, Heidi Mollenhauer is a great singer and performer and has this wonderful kind of slightly smoky quality to her voice that is an excellent excellent match for Demi Moore. I think if most people not knowing two different actresses played the part would never guess. It flows into the song so easily.
Absolutely. We used to play it for people and they were sure it was Demi, but it's Heidi. Here's one of my favorite scenes in the show coming up. All these candles coming in front of Esmeralda here. It gives you a really nice sense of depth.
This is a real great Disney moment here.
This is an area where we had to go back and forth. How are we going to bring Quasimodo into the song? How are we going to attach him to Esmeralda? How are we going to involve him in this sequence?
We were worried
because we kind of lose him for a while.
So midway through, we decided to make him a witness, to kind of watching this whole thing. And in a way, this is where he really kind of bonds with her.
I think we redid the bridge to this song about three or four times. All the selfish parishioners coming in and praying, in contrast to Esmeralda, we worked on forever. And this whole idea of the stained glass window is kind of a recent idea in the making of the film. And there's even some fun little guild signs hidden in the window.
Down at the base of the window, if you look at the little square panels that the guilds traditionally put in, you know, the sponsors of the window in the church, you'll find the guild for the layout department, the computer department, the animation department.
You'll notice this fresco in back of Esmeralda is actually something that you'll find in Notre Dame. It's called the Slaughter of the Innocents. Most of the statues and frescoes and things that she passes during the song are really there in the cathedral. We painstakingly reproduced it.
Paul and Gaetan were really careful about this.
Yeah, including the rose window here, which is kind of the centerpiece of the cathedral in that beautiful long shot, which we retook about three or four times. We used to have dust in the air, and it It never quite worked.
Yeah, we had animated dust particles in the air, and the scale was off. For some reason, the individual particles looked like they were the size of Esmeralda's head.
Like a nuclear accident.
Yeah, and it just really wasn't working.
It worked nice here, though. Yeah. The kind of just drifting...
Sort of drifting smoke, yeah. It really gives a great feeling like there's incense in the place.
You, Bellringer, haven't you caused enough trouble already?
Well, this little sequence kind of leads us into a moment where we're trying to get Esmeralda and Quasimodo to bond a little bit, where he takes her up to his bell tower and shows her his cool loft apartment.
This was actually a scene that we rewrote several times, and the final version was actually based on a suggestion by Demi Moore. She felt that Esmeralda, having grown up on the very crowded streets of Paris, you know, with the gypsy caravan, everybody kind of living on top of each other, that when she first saw Quasimodo's loft,
his spacious loft,
the amount of space and light and the fact that he had it all to himself would be really a wonderful thing for her, that to her that would be a wonderful way to live. So we thought just showing that contrast between the two would be very interesting.
Here comes a wonderful little scene when Esmeralda crests the floor here and sees the loft for the first time right here. It looks like a 3D model, but it's really not. The floor is squeezed. It's a two-dimensional painting that's squeezed and then unsqueezed to make it look like the floor recedes away from it.
Some layout magic, again, by Ed Gertner.
And then when you get up into the loft, Chris Jenkins and his effects guys did some really nice work with the mobile and the little shards of light moving around the room. It really makes you feel a sense of space.
It's very magical. We wanted this to kind of be, you know, Quasimodo's life seen in a different way, seen literally in a different light. Some more great Ron Husband animation on Jolly.
Ron took a character that was really kind of a minor character, the goat Jolly, and took it to a level where the executives began to demand more Jolly, more goat. Because every time the goat would come on, he was a star.
Yeah, we doubled his
screen time.
Yeah, he was so charming and fun in every scene that he was in that we eventually had to work him into more scenes, and that's really credit to Ron Husband.
This is kind of a Victor Hugo scene, the idea of Quasimodo and his bells and his relationship to his bells up in his tower.
Yeah, in fact, all the names he gave to the bells are the names that they have in the original novel.
Now here's Quasimodo showing her the best view in town, complete with English chorus.
I bet the king himself doesn't have a view like this.
Actually, the king does have a feel. Yeah, he lives in the South Tower.
Yeah, we don't want to shed a light on that.
That was actually a Will Finn, our head of story. That was his one of his contributions. I bet the king himself doesn't have a view like this. He felt that in a way that Quasimodo doesn't understand, he's
what he has, right?
Yeah, he doesn't understand what he has right beneath him.
This prison that Quasimodo lives in actually has a really, you know, a silver lining to it.
You notice a really neat, subtle lighting change through this whole scene where it goes from the sun setting and each scene progressively gets a little bit darker, a little bluer, the stars start to come out.
Yeah, it actually becomes night over the course of this little palm reading scene. And again, this scene was meant to show the common thread that ran through both Quasimodo and Esmeralda.
The outcast notion of both of them. She's a social outcast, a gypsy, who lives on the fringes of society, and he's
an outcast because of just his physical body, because of his appearance, and in a way, they are the same, and that's what the scene is meant to convey.
Here's the biggest laugh in the show coming up here.
And Laverne says truss, not dress, but it's funny either way. The kids laugh when they hear dress, and the adults laugh when they hear truss. So.
I sure do, yeah. This builds up to one of my favorite little action sequences in the film.
Yes, we kind of called this King Kong in reverse.
Now I'm afraid. There's some great layout work in here. Actually,
this is a secret scene here on that balcony that's swinging back and forth down below the camera, or, you know, about halfway down the cathedral. You'll find statues of Donald Duck and Goofy.
I love this scene. So it's beautiful layout work, beautiful background painting. It's just where everything combines to be a beautiful scene.
Kind of a fun thrill ride sequence.
Jason Alexander did some play-by-play descriptions for this. We had a gag one time where the gargoyles kind of narrated the
like it was a bobsled run in the Winter Olympics. Jason was going, Quasimodo certainly looks good today. Back in the Vatican Games of 1438, it was.
Here comes another big laugh in the movie, where the goat.
That was the very talented Gary Trousdale again.
That's
the goat.
I'm never going back out there again.
Notice how he says the word out there.
I hadn't noticed that before.
It's a theme.
As though it were planned.
This was a scene that, again, was created by Will Finn, our head of story. The writing process is very collaborative in animation, and we not only had a team of writers, but our story people also contributed a great deal of dialogue.
This whole idea of the amulet and kind of visualizing the location of the cathedral and the Court of Miracles is kind of an interesting idea.
Kind of abstract map.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
It's one of my favorite scenes where Esmeralda appears to jump in the sand right here.
Boosh! Splash! Not really.
Always did miss that sound effect, though.
Yeah.
We always added it whenever we'd screen it for ourselves.
No soldiers! Sanctuary! Get out! Wait!
There's Quasimodo in kind of his guard dog mode.
We wanted to have a scene where Quasimodo acted a little bit more like the movie monster we all know and love. Just for one instance, we got to see his scary side.
You see the potential that he can be pretty fearsome.
And this kind of comes into play later in the siege of the cathedral. We really get to see him cut loose and show how physically strong he is. This kind of foreshadows that.
It's played for a joke, but he's really strong. He's holding up Phoebus and a full suit of armor with one hand.
He has the strength of 10 hunchbacks.
It also kind of connects...
Plus two.
It connects Quasimodo and Phoebus by the end of the scene. They have a little... You know that they're kind of hit it off a little bit. Just a little.
Used to be a joke here where Hugo said, Hey, the hunch is back!
The power of the tower.
But...
it didn't seem like it fit.
Yeah.
This is one of my favorite Mary Wicks lines. Mary was, she was such a trooper.
Yeah.
She was bringing out the such a wealth of experience she had. I mean, she told us a story that her first job in theater was
Margaret Hamilton's understudy on Broadway. She went way back, spanned several generations of showbiz history.
Vaudevillian.
Great lady.
Interesting bit about this particular song. We actually had Tom Hulse singing it in a higher key, and we went back even after the animation was done and had him sing it in a slightly lower key.
It didn't sound like Quasimodo. He was
up here. Yeah,
it was real high and sweet.
Yeah,
but a little. Mm-hmm.
It was a little got a little too much of a choir boy vibe off of it, and we decided that maybe if we lower the key a little bit, it's actually Chris Montan's suggestion. It might sound a little more like the character.
We also put some jokes in here after we previewed it once or twice. We found it could just use a little leavening here and
there.
It was a beautiful sequence, and Brenda Chapman had boarded this, and we all fell in love with it from the first storyboards. But
bit of a twitch and squirm factor. That we needed to kind of. Lesson, so we decided to add a little bit of humorous counterpoint with the gargoyles, particularly this bit here.
We hope Brenda forgives us.
Big laugh right there.
But I still think this is a beautiful sequence. The music is gorgeous. The art direction, Dave really outdid himself. Mm-hmm. I love the blue light.
The backgrounds are beautiful. Lisa Keene and her group. And, of course, the camera pan here is one big, long, continuous pullback.
One long pan. That was actually our favorite Chinese restaurant.
Yeah.
One long pan.
Delicious. Love the egg rolls. It's a tricky little transition that we worked on for about 6 months and finally ended up with this.
It took forever. We had to match the speed of the clapper to the speed
of the sensor.
Of the swinging incense sensor.
If you've tried at home, you know it's very difficult. It's beautiful effects, Chris Jenkins and his
Chris effects,
gorgeous incense up in the air.
And Steven took an actual mass for this.
I mean, yeah.
This is all real
Latin mass chanting, but the Latin is 100% real.
Authentic Latin for your viewing pleasure.
Leads us into a part of the movie which is, A personal favorite of all of ours, I think.
Yeah, this is the Hellfire sequence, which was fairly controversial.
But, are we allowed to say Hellfire?
But very, but very important to the entire. Very important in staying true to the spirit of Victor Hugo, the torture that Frollo feels over being drawn to this gypsy woman, even though it goes against his belief, was dramatized so effectively by this great song by Alan and Steven.
And I think some of the best animation possibly ever done by Kathy Zielinski, who really took this whole sequence under her wing and animated all the Frollo
in the series. She really shepherded this through.
Yeah, it's a real showcase for Kathy.
The effects department really knocked themselves out, too. Chris Jenkins took this scene himself. He felt this was really important. Chris was our head of special effects, and he and I went through every frame, making sure that it was suitable for all ages.
Yeah, making sure that Esmeralda was fully clothed, even though she's portrayed as a fire spirit.
And this Paul and Gaetan Brizzi storyboard this whole sequence, and it turns into kind of Frollo's nightmare here.
Mr. Frollo's wild ride is what we called this.
We encouraged Paul and Gaetan to kind of go very far out and make this kind of a demented fantasy of Frollo's, and they took us at our word.
They locked themselves in their office for like 2 weeks, and then they came back with this board that was in color.
Yeah.
And presented it to us, and they were very nervous when they presented it to us.
Well, it was very silent afterwards. Everyone was just kind of like, wow, kind of blown away by the intensity of it. And they said, have we gone too far? And we said, no.
No, this is great.
So
hope we get it by the executives.
Yeah, fortunately, but everybody backed us up on this.
Everybody
they
loved this.
They understood how thematically important it was, and it was very much in the spirit of like Night on Bald Mountain and Fantasia, just one of those great kind of dark and surreal Disney moments.
That was our argument. We had all these arguments all lined up. If Michael Eisner and Roy Disney didn't like it, we'd say, oh, it's like Fantasia. It's like all these other things.
Turned out we didn't have to use them.
We didn't have to use them. They said, hey, this is great. Dark
fire. This really turns into Fantasia for me at the end. Just singing and all the shadows appearing on the wall.
And again, just great cooperation between all the departments. Great animation by Kathy, great effects by the effects department. You know, based on an excellent storyboard and a terrific song. It's like all the elements coming together.
All the shadow work and the ensuing like specters and spirits flying around Frollo were done by Ed Coffey, who he's somebody else who thought, was he taking it too far? Is this too much? And we kept saying, no, do more, do more. He was more than happy to do more.
It's a great shot here, the way the camera cranes up. And here's some more of our ham-fisted symbolism. Frollo falls down in the shape of a crucifix.
This sets us up for a sequence that we must have boarded at least 10 times.
Yeah, it was originally much longer. There was a lot more of the soldiers, ransacking the city of Paris, but ultimately we decided a little bit of this went a long way.
A little more of cat and mouse between Esmeralda and the soldiers as well. She was featured more in the sequence.
Take them away!
You get a little sense of London chorus and pipe organ playing over that sequence too. We spent a whole day in London doing a recording session in a cathedral of a great old pipe organ to get that sense of mass over the top of the score.
Our home is always open to the weary traveler.
This is Alan, one of Alan's nicer cues too. I mean, he does the danger music really well.
He likes it, I think.
He likes it.
Yeah. I assure you, we know nothing of these gypsies. We worked really hard to get all these flames and the fire sequence coming up looking like fire. It's hard to do with artwork and animation, but there's a gentleman named Randy Fulmer, who's a jack-of-all-trades kind of guy. We call him our artistic coordinator, and he takes the world of artwork and mingles it with the world of technology to get a lot of these effects up on the screen. So a lot of this material that's coming up is a real tribute to Randy.
In this shot here, we originally had a line of dialogue from Phoebus where he said, I won't follow the orders of a madman. And we decided, based on Stephen Schwartz's suggestion, that the scene would be more powerful if we didn't realize exactly what action Phoebus was going to take until he doused the torch in the barrel.
Boy, that's a flammable house.
That is, yeah. This was the kerosene mill, apparently.
It's a very dangerous occupation.
Goes up mighty fast.
Yeah.
So, it was a sequence that was boarded a number of times, too, I believe.
Yeah. used to laugh at that "don't hit my horse" line too, but unfortunately no one else did.
You notice Phoebus is shot in the shoulder, but he grabs his chest.
It's a common thing. There's a little scene coming up, wasn't there, where Esmeralda had to actually dive under the water?
Yeah, we had storyboarded the scene of Esmeralda diving under the water and removing Phoebus's heavy breastplate, which is what made him sink like a stone in the first place. But due to time constraints, we ended up cutting it. So
that all takes place right here. Now, okay.
Very quick.
Yeah, she's...
We kind of infer. Here's another scene with all these levels of artwork, all the building levels that Ed Gertner orchestrated, and all the levels of fire and smoke that Randy Fulmer worked in.
It's actually only one level of smoke and one level of fire, and just by doing some distortion using the computer, we're able to make it look like it was rippling and flowing.
In the background of this scene, you hear what we call our loop group, which is basically a bunch of people we get in around microphones to give us
The teeming hordes of Paris.
Even though you don't see them, you can kind of hear them. And this is a sequence where, right before we recorded the final version of the sequence, Mary Wicks,
our actress for Laverne.
Yeah, she passed away very unfortunately, and we loved her a great deal, but we had a few more lines of dialogue for her. And we ended up bringing in an actress named Jane Withers, who's famous for the Comet Cleanser commercials.
Josephine the Plumber.
Josephine the Lady Plumber, to come in and double for Mary Wicks on a few of these lines here. She did such a good job that it's almost impossible to tell where Mary leaves off and Jane begins. There are some lines in the sequence where
the sentence is divided between the two actresses. And Jane was such a sweetheart about it, too.
Yeah.
I mean, she was honored to do it, she said.
This next sequence is actually a real kind of tour de force for Jason Alexander and Charles Kimbrough and Mary Wicks, who do a wonderful job performing these characters and singing them in this sequence. This is a sequence we really thought was important because we needed to lighten the mood a little bit after all this sturm and drang that's happened in the last 5 minutes, and also build Quasimodo's hopes up. We're kind of setting him up for a fall.
We've always operated under the assumption that the gargoyles were kind of figments of Quasimodo's imagination. They didn't really move around, or did they? You know.
Yeah, we liked leaving a little bit of a question mark, kind of like Harvey the Rabbit or Calvin and Hobbes.
They're inanimate when anybody else comes in the room. They don't talk to anybody else except the goat. So that, you know, that's where we kind of cross the line a little bit.
We'd like to keep it a little.
Yeah, that's okay.
A little bit iffy.
But this is where Quasimodo is really, he's really getting lost in this fantasy.
Daydream. We tried to make the backgrounds become more and more stylized over the course of this. Again, just to sort of clue the audience in that this isn't really happening.
It's kind of
happening in Quasimodo's mind.
It's a dream. He's hoping that he does really have a chance with Esmeralda.
And since the gargoyles are kind of fantasy comedy characters, we felt we had license to be a little more broad here, you know, turning them into poker players and barbers and the whole deal.
That's always been kind of a Disney thing, that when you're dealing with magic characters, they can do things that the rest of the characters can't, you know.
Here comes one of my favorite rhymes by Mr. Stephen Schwartz. Like a croissant. Not everyone would think to rhyme Adonis and croissant is. I think that's brilliant.
Yeah. We set them off to write this comic song, and they came in one day. I think they were a little nervous, actually. And we sat down in a music room upstairs with a piano and proceeded to play this, and we laughed ourselves silly.
They played it on the piano. They played it on the piano, and we were just falling on the floor.
Obligatory gargoyle and drag gag.
You find that in most of the versions of Hunchback of Notre Dame.
Yeah.
Over the decades.
I remember it from the original Hugo, It's amazing. Jason Alexander, who we all know from Seinfeld, is such a great singer.
He's terrific.
Yeah.
Who knew?
But so is Charles Kimbrough.
Yeah.
He really belts it out.
They all delivered great.
I think that was one of the few times where we actually had the actors in the same room.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, it's true.
Charles and Jason were both in the same room.
Yeah.
Mary Wicks, however, we had a separate.
It's one of the saddest scenes coming up here when he goes back to reality here. It's really
Blink.
Yeah. Oh. Contrast that with the earlier shot of all the banners and flowers and pigeons, and you'll see that everything is just kind of Quasimodo's decrepit old junk. We really wanted to show the contrast between his fantasy and what the reality was.
This is Phoebus. He's my boyfriend. He wrecked his dad's car. Can he stay in your apartment for a while?
That's kind of what the scene is.
That's kind of what it is. I mean, we joked about that, but that's, you know, that's really what's going on.
The real life parallel. This is some terrific animation of Russ Edmonds as Phoebus and Anne-Marie Bardwell as Esmeralda, and some great vocal performances by Kevin Kline and Demi Moore.
Yeah, we toyed with having a song here for about 5 minutes one day. And it just didn't seem to fire off because it put too much emphasis on the romance, and it was really a scene about Quasimodo's heartbreak.
It was a really pretty romantic song.
But the point of view was from the wrong character, that we really wanted this scene to be seen through Quasimodo's eyes.
Yeah, here it comes.
You can hear the glass tinkle.
Yeah.
Oh. And for those of you who didn't know that Quasimodo's heart was breaking, we provide a handy visual aid
for those six-year-olds in the audience who may not understand what's going on here. It's the world's longest kiss going on in the background, too, but they are French after all. It's a nice little emotional flashback to Quasi's hopes being dashed on the rocks of life.
Using the same words.
And there it is.
Here we go.
Get it?
Rip.
Broken heart.
I'll get it.
Yeah.
It's the goat.
Goat doorbell. Uh-oh, here comes the bad guy.
Here comes Frollo.
Yeah. There's a terrific sequence coming up that also was storyboarded by Paul and Gaetan Britzi that we called Frollo Dearest.
It's where Frollo comes up to grill Quasimodo. He suspects something.
And he's going to sweat Quasimodo out until he admits his involvement in Esmeralda's escape.
There was a funny little bit here we had to cut out. When Laverne says, "Quick, we have to stash the stiff," we had a whole series of gargoyles hiding Phoebus' unconscious body in funny ways, and we just ran out of time.
We settled for a swift kick in the butt.
A quick boot in the pants.
Yeah, which always goes over big.
Again, terrific art direction here. Dave lit it with this great kind of yellow candlelight, and it even makes their skin look a little yellowy. He was trying for a very kind of eerie, uncomfortable feeling here.
And Alan Menken did the score on this, where it's a little bit of the world is cruel.
Yeah, it's kind of a slightly psychotic rendering of the opening song.
Frollo's song.
Here's the world's most dangerous grape. Careful, don't touch it. Oh no!
Oh no, Master. You're not eating.
Sean Keller did the animation of Quasimodo. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, he looks wonderfully guilty.
I like the tension, and then it's when Frollo finally breaks and starts clearing the table and yelling at Quasimodo. It's really effective.
Yeah, there's a lot of suspense here, and then when Frollo finally loses it, a lot of impact.
And all the tabletop dolls and things come in handy again. It just as a metaphor for him cleaning house and dealing with Esmeralda.
And if Frollo wasn't bad enough, he wrecks all of Quasimodo's toys.
Yeah, he is a baddie.
He's about as bad as they come.
Look at that. That's unforgivable.
What a jerk. I suppose this little moment where he scorches Esmeralda's doll is a little forecast of things to come.
Yes, this is Frollo illustrating what his plans are. You know, Frollo has a real obsession with fire. Fire is kind of one of the symbols that goes hand in hand with Frollo throughout the entire movie.
The purifying fire.
It's the purifying flame.
There's a great little glance coming up here when Frollo turns around and walks down the stairs. Kind of a knowing glance that he just set up Quasimodo.
Frollo is the king of the knowing smirk. You'll notice that the score actually goes away for a little bit here. There's no background music. And we thought this was very effective, particularly after that huge raging scene with Frollo. To have a little bit of silence in the background here, and also to kind of give you a rest period before all the action heats up in the third act.
I like how they grab the same shoulder here. It's kind of a metaphor that they share each other's pain.
They are brothers, in a way.
We storyboarded this area a lot of times too, just trying to find the right balance between the...
Well, exactly what Quasimodo's emotion should be at this point.
And John Ripa did a really great scene here, and a nice delivery from Tom Hulse to bring you this moment of Quasimodo's...
Tom Hulse did a fantastic job here.
Yeah.
I think he recorded this once, and we said, that's it.
He nailed it. One take, Tom.
I'm tired of trying to be something that I'm not.
He said, do you want me to do that again? No. Yeah.
This scene ends really sweetly, too, without a word, with Laverne just coming over with his cloak.
That is one crispy gypsy. That's a line Jason used to say at this point.
Phoebus! Shh! I'm coming with you.
One of my favorite scenes, the whisper fight that comes up here, which, oddly enough, we didn't record these two actors in the same room at the same time.
We had Tom Hulse in California doing his half of the whisper fight, and then Kevin Kline in New York listened to a tape of Tom Hulse in his headphones and recorded his half.
No, a lot of the improvs and timing and things that come from Kevin Kline are just, you know, off the cuff things that he did in the recording studio.
They're all his own. We recorded so... Kevin Kline was so gifted at coming up with his own kind of funny lines, we were only able to use a fraction of them here in the movie.
You just turn on the mic and let him go.
It's some great animation by Russ Edmonds and Ralph Palmer in that whisper fight scene.
This kind of sets us up for a great part of the movie, the Court of Miracles, and the whole lead into it and the catacombs are inspired by, I think, one of the early field trips to Paris.
Yeah, we actually went to the catacombs of Paris that are beneath the city, and it's several miles of tunnels that are festooned with skulls and bones.
There's a McDonald's down there.
Hidden jokes.
A nice little coffee shop. Yeah. But it's a great place. We wanted to work it into the story.
Hidden jokes coming up. On the tombstones throughout this graveyard are the names of the layout department. And on the top of the sarcophagus here is a caricature of our head of layout.
There he is.
Ed Gertner is the knight who's supposedly entombed here.
And one of the coolest scenes in the movie here, which also resembles Gary's house at Halloween, is this scene right here.
I
the
catacombs. Wish.
Yeah, it's really great.
If you go to Paris, you'll see this place.
That's a lot of heads.
It's a little drier than this, but...
There used to be a whole sequence here where the skeletons actually jumped down and fought them. There was a little action sequence
here. The idea was that the gypsies had rigged up marionettes made out of skeletons to scare people who got this far, who got this close to their lair.
Yeah, so we had a whole sword fight action sequence with these skeleton marionettes that we eventually cut.
So, yeah, the kind of holdover you see now is gypsies dressed in skeleton suits.
Yeah, skeleton garb.
It's the kind of survivor of that idea.
And here's Clopin in his new outfit.
His purple outfit. These are his street clothes as opposed to his performing clothes.
We shoot live-action actors from time to time just as models for inspiration for the animators. And I think Mike Suri, the animator for Clopin, used a lot of live-action reference as inspiration for a lot of Clopin's performances here. This is also a scene where we... had a cast of thousands to animate on the screen. And the pencil mileage with all the skeletons and the bones and things was pretty intense.
And considering how many thousands there are, we actually got away with, by judicious use
judicious
of camera
editing,
angles.
Yeah.
And,
you never see everybody on screen at the same time.
You see in the art direction here again, Dave Goetz and Lisa Keene, our head of background, wanted to make this a real colorful gypsy world. So it's lots of fabrics draped around.
It's more organic and colorful.
We wanted to contrast the sort of coldness of this underground lair. We wanted to show that they turned it really bright and welcoming with all this color and tapestry.
This is actually the third song written for this location. There were other songs. There was a romance, two love songs, I guess, written early on.
The first one was called In a Court of Miracles, which was basically Phoebus and Esmeralda. Again.
Yeah, and Quasimodo saw himself reflected in a chalice, and the chalice's curved surface distorted Quasimodo so that he appeared handsome in the chalice for one magic moment.
Right.
And it was very nice. It was all very emotional. But again, the emphasis seemed to be on the wrong characters. It was all about the love story between Phoebus and Esmeralda. And ultimately, we realized that's not the story that we're telling.
The second song was even more so. It was called As Long as There's a Moon, and it was also called The Gypsy Wedding Song.
It involved Quasimodo more in the action, but still, it was a case of spotlight shining on the wrong part of the stage.
They're beautiful songs. They just didn't quite fit in with the story we were telling. There was a long, protracted scene in here where we used that idea of Quasimodo seeing his reflection in the chalice to kind of point up his ugliness and how he felt out of place with Phoebus and Esmeralda.
20 years of searching. These Frollo scenes were actually animated by Ruben Aquino, who was kind of our guest animator towards the end of the production from Florida.
One of our Florida stars.
Yeah, it was a real task to pull all the elements of the production together, and we had a great production team led by Phil LaFaro, our associate producer, Roy Conley, our co-producer in Paris, and Patty Hicks, our production manager, who had to pull together studios in Paris, Florida, and Los Angeles, and recording sessions in London and New York and
Seattle and Seattle, Fort Lauderdale,
all over the globe. And you forget how much of an international movie these things can be by the time they're all done.
It's also their job to wrangle us. Mm-hmm. Without them,
they keep us on schedule.
Without them, God knows we would just wander around aimlessly and play video games.
Yeah, eat donuts into the night. Well, here comes a stretch of film that is absolutely, I think, our collective favorites, this whole climax of the movie.
That's what we told the press, anyway.
Yeah.
They'd ask, what is your favorite film? I always said this part.
Yeah, the sequence is our favorite. It's got amazing music, the Latin chanting that Steven supplied us with. If you're actually a Latin buff and you translate it, it is actually thematically tied into what's happening in the scene.
The chorus is chanting about saving us from judgment in the time of trial.
There used to be a long sequence, actually, that was cut before this whole scene where Frollo approached Esmeralda in the dungeon, like the night before.
It was very similar to the scene in the book where Frollo and Esmeralda speak in the dungeon and he confesses his love for her, but we decided to move that action right there on the stage where Esmeralda was going to be executed just for expediency and for drama.
To energize it a little bit more.
And we go up and we see Quasimodo at his lowest point in the film.
He's the defeated fighter on the ropes. And
kind of in the ropes at this point.
And his coaches have to make him rekindle his fighting spirit. He's given up at this point.
They do the Burgess Meredith kind of Rocky speech.
He's a wrecking machine. What's holding you
back, Quasimodo? Leave me alone. Some very loaded lines here. These chains aren't holding you back.
Okay.
And here comes my favorite line.
We'll leave you alone.
After all, we're only made out of stone.
We just thought maybe you were made of something stronger.
Kind of sums up the whole movie right there.
There we go.
That hurts to the core.
For justice, for Paris, and for her own salvation. It is my
great cue here. Man, it gives me goosebumps still.
Yeah. You know, there's a guy named Michael Starobin who orchestrated all this with Alan, and just a brilliant orchestration and made this whole sequence work. And here Quasimodo eats his spinach and comes out fighting.
Yeah, somewhere between Samson and the Incredible Hulk.
This is just the best animation moment because you have everybody, background painters, art direction, special effects, musicians, everybody firing off on both barrels.
Soon we have the computer department like showing themselves at full force.
Yeah.
These upcoming shots, it's basically every trick we have in our entire arsenal we're showing off at once here.
It's the combined equivalent of putting the wildebeest stampede from Lion King into the
ballroom
and Beauty and the Beast.
And lighting it on fire.
And burning the whole thing down.
Yeah. And there it is for your enjoyment.
Well, we've said before, and we'll say it again, the entire film has been an elaborate prologue up to this point. This is the whole reason for making this film, is this sequence right here.
And speaking of King Kong, James Baxter, the animator, actually stole one of King Kong's glances. Back to the crowd.
His defiant glance.
And the big goosebump moment of the whole movie.
Man,
right here.
I just love this. This, like Gary said, this was the whole reason to make the movie for us.
Cast of thousands down there. It's just beautiful.
Captain, seize the cathedral.
Now this takes off into a scene that was kind of a balancing act for the story guys because it was a combination, very dramatic siege of the cathedral scene, but it also had to be funny because you wanted to have fun action gags of the gargoyles pouring stuff down on the silly guards below. So now Quasi drops this huge beam on Frollo's car, so to speak, and his hat goes flying off.
And we never see his hat again.
Thank God we got rid of that
Everybody was happy when that happened.
Don't have to draw it anymore. There's a little speech coming up that Phoebus makes, and it used to be Clopin's speech.
Yeah, we decided to give it to Phoebus instead of Clopin because Phoebus needed to be more involved in the action and kind of have a big rally the troops moment.
It ends up with him saying, "Will we allow it?"
And at that point, Laverne used to, the gargoyles used to say, "What did he say?" And Laverne said, "I think he said someone stole his wallet." But we decided that was one too many hard of hearing gags.
Also, the momentum was going so much. We did have a lot of gags here.
It's hard to stop the fun.
Yeah, you wanted to keep the pace quick.
Our story guys came up with endless gags for what could happen here between gargoyles and guards.
This is
a
scene.
Kirk's scene.
Yeah, I actually
Kirk animated that one.
That guard being hit on the head with a brick. That was mine.
It's a combination of computer-generated crowds in the background and hand-animated material in the foreground.
Yeah.
And a reprise of our... funny heretic
Our
guy.
Our favorite heretic. This is Gary's scene right here. He animated the guards falling down into the water.
To their watery death.
Beautifully done.
Their watery, funny death.
James Fuji storyboarded this gag here with the delayed action catapult
the
gag.
The reverse catapult.
When we previewed the movie, I used to love this part because I knew that the big laughs were coming up.
Yeah.
You had surefire laugh right here with the guard.
The reprise of the famous horse sits on guard gag.
The big funny flatulent noise.
Yeah, and possibly the biggest laugh of the movie.
Yeah.
Homage to Wizard of Oz.
Both the Wizard of Oz and the birds.
And the birds, yeah.
This was devised by story man John Sanford.
Beautiful. The effects work in here is second to none. Effects animator Marlon West did a lot of the molten lava here, along with Doris Lamper.
And here he is, cinema first, the lava cam.
And it sets you up for the big icon from the book, the movie.
There it is.
There it is, ladies
zillion
and gentlemen.
CGI crowds, lava. That's like the definitive scene of the Hunchback of Notre Dame.
You don't
see
that every day.
Thank you, folks. Wait, there's more.
I hear we need a scene really for the Archdeacon more than anything.
Yeah, to kind of at least make him attempt to stop Frollo. Otherwise, we thought it would seem a little ineffectual.
He was kind of absent for a long time. Didn't Frollo used to punch the Archdeacon?
Yeah, we thought that was a little
slam
much.
Slam him up against the wall or something.
He's punching the clergy. Come
and see. And here's that classic...
Big uh-oh moment,
This doesn't look good.
We literally, at test screenings, we heard uh-ohs. And,
it was very sweet.
Yeah. This scene's really effective. Some really nice animation by James Baxter and his crew.
It shows you how acting is so tough in animation, and you don't realize here's somebody doing 24 drawings a second of film, and it's not moving around a lot, but it's a very sensitive little performance. Not any dialogue. It's just a very... solemn moment, and it works like $1 million.
Here's that boys' choir again. Kind of doing a angelic reprise of the theme that's played when the two of them are up on the roof together. Kind of calls back that moment.
Sequence was boarded by Brenda Chapman.
It's a lovely moment, and then, of course, the bad guy walks in, and with him he brings
his own scary red light.
Which
we could justify story-wise by the fact that the fire was burning outside, so we were able to give the place a red menacing glow.
Yeah, we wanted the audience to have one of those watch out behind you kind of scenes.
Look out behind you moment.
Even though Quasimodo was hopeless here, didn't really care what was happening.
But there's a great moment come up when they're facing each other and fighting, and Quasimodo looks into Frollo's eyes and realizes that he's been lied to his whole life.
Yeah, he sees just the
right there,
hate in Frollo's face and realizes that.
And then he just eats his spinach and just nails Frollo here.
Another animation guest star, Charlie Bonifacio, a very talented Canadian animator who did a couple of these scenes here.
She lives.
Now, this whole climactic battle on top of the parapets of Notre Dame was also a real international production.
Real collaboration. It was storyboards, again, by Paul and Gaetan Britzi. Backgrounds and layouts produced in Paris, and animation produced both in Paris and California.
And Randy Fulmer, our artistic coordinator, did a cool thing because there's constantly smoke rising up from the square below, and it becomes more and more impressionistic as you go. The town square actually disappears after a while and turns into a hellish kind of hotbed down there.
Yeah, we were also sort of trying to set up this whole metaphor of Frollo kind of plunging into this fiery abyss below, kind of a hell-like fire below.
A lot of people think some of these trefoil shapes on the cathedral are Mickey Mouse shapes, and they're really not.
They're actually on the cathedral itself. They weren't meant to be little homages to Mickey Mouse.
There is, in fact, photographic reference at your local library for you to on this.
The gargoyles that you see all over the cathedral during the sequence, those are the actual gargoyles on Notre Dame in their exact locations. We actually were very accurate at this point in our reproductions of the gargoyles. So that warthog one that people sometimes think is Pumbaa is not Pumbaa. It's an actual gargoyle.
It's a warthog gargoyle.
This series of reverses here, I think, Kirk and Gary worked really hard to try to get a sense of increasing peril through here. And I remember sitting on a scoring stage once, even with Alan, trying to get the score to do the same thing to indicate that kind of rising levels of peril going up to this speech here.
Here's Frollo's moment of extreme psychosis.
And extreme pain, actually.
And there he goes.
There he goes. Bye-bye, Frollo. Thanks for playing.
That's kind of our tribute to Dr. Strangelove there.
Major Kong riding the bomb.
Yeah. In a final twist, though, here goes Quasi.
Oh, he's dead, too.
Bye-bye now.
Well, I didn't expect that, did you?
A last-minute save.
And now the light changes. It's no longer red. It's a little purple.
It's dawn, actually.
It's dawn.
We tried to
been fighting all night.
Yeah, it's been a long, rough night for all of them.
It's kind of sunrise up out there now.
It's funny in animation how art direction can really help manipulate the emotions of the moment and the time of day, and even the costumery and the way the scene looks helps you tell the story.
The scene here is what originally was a payoff for a sequence that was cut out. We mentioned the gypsy wedding song before.
Originally, Quasimodo had to join their hands in the course of this gypsy wedding song, but the song was interrupted, and there he joins his hands. But we decided to leave the hand-joining moment because it was still very emotional.
Now it's a bright new day.
Now it's morning.
And pretty much from the point that Quasimodo is caught by Phoebus to the end of the movie, there is not a single line of dialogue spoken. And I think that's a real tribute to the quality of the animation and just to the power of animation as being a visual medium. All of the rest of the story is told in pantomime.
If you like, we can explain what's going on.
But I think everyone gets the idea. This is about Quasimodo finally stepping out into
the light.
Sun. The light, literally, and being accepted.
James even had his pupils dilate in the light.
Yeah, that's a nice little touch. We go back and take a look at that.
There's our boys' choir again.
It's a very tender moment, and these are tricky to pull off in animation without it seeming
real schmaltzy or fake.
Mm-hmm. But I think James just did a great job here. And again, with the support of Alan's music, you get a really great, warm feeling.
Now this sets us up for a series of parting shots and almost curtain calls for the characters. Give you the satisfaction of getting to say goodbye to these characters that you spent the last 90 minutes with.
So, bye-bye, Clopin.
Bye-bye, Quasimodo.
Bye-bye, Gargoyles.
See you, Gargoyles. You were fun.
And even a little curtain call for the goat. It's
Mr. and Mrs. Phoebus.
That leads
and their kid.
Yeah. Leads us into possibly the biggest pullback shot in animation history here. A cast of thousands.
Just when you think it's going to cut, no, it just keeps pulling back further and further and further.
Ed Gertner, Randy Fulmer. We blame you for this shot.
Even a little final homage to Mary Wicks and the pigeons there.
Through the clouds, just the way we began. It's kind of a bookend thing.
Mm-hmm. And a classic Disney happy ending to The Hunchback of Notre Dame. Well, there it is, The Hunchback of Notre Dame. And I don't know about you, but I am ready for the showers. the process of making an animated film is pretty amazing, because you have 600 people over 4 years, in this case spread out over a couple of continents, and it's a really, really collaborative thing. I think the idea for this film started 3 or 4 years before it was released. A guy named David Stainton, who is one of our very talented development executives at the studio.
Yeah, he was the first one to propose doing an adaptation of Hunchback of Notre Dame in animation, and he brought on a writer named Tab Murphy, who developed a treatment for the story.
And when you think about it, we've done a lot of animation based on children's literature, like Bambi or Jungle Book, but we've never done a film based on a widely read, widely accepted piece of literature like Victor Hugo's Hunchback of Notre Dame.
What you'd call adult literature.
Yeah. But on further analysis, Gary and I realized that there were aspects of the story that were so archetypal, if you will, that it read almost like a fairy tale.
When you strip the story down to its bare bones, you've got a monster who lives in a tower.
Locked in a tower by his evil stepfather.
A beautiful dancer and a knight on a horse. And just great. Great kind of fairy tale elements that come together.
One of the funny things about making the movie was we were so worried about the French reaction to taking a classic piece of French literature.
Yeah.
It turns out to be this huge hit in France. It was the number one movie of the year when it was released.
Giant movie in Paris. They went nuts for it. That was actually very gratifying.
But there was some nervousness on our part that, Disney's running roughshod over a French national treasure. Disney's doing their Disney thing, and they loved it.
And part of it was the ability to work with a bunch of Parisian artists who not only were familiar with the literature, but they walked out their front door every day and there was Notre Dame, and they were able to study it and at least help us understand the cultural concerns and the architecture and all the things that went into the making of the movie. The process of hatching a movie too depends on a lot of people up front. The writing staff kind of passes the baton to the story crew, and we had a really great story crew on this film.
Yeah, we had a terrific group of writers.
Bob and Noni, Bob Zutiker and Noni White, and Irene Mecki and Jonathan Roberts, who wrote a little bit on Lion King, were some of the people that came in. And just around the table with the directors and the story staff helped to knock ideas around, and that collaboration breeds a lot of what you saw on the screen here. The animators are also always stars of the show. And
it can't be said enough. The animators are our actors, and take their characters just as seriously and put as much passion and thought into their drawn performance as any actor on film or stage would.
There's a group of people we didn't talk about too much, the cleanup artists who take the animators' performances, which are often drawn very sketchily and kind of rough on a piece of paper.
It's their job to make these rough kind of inconsistent drawings from like 30 to 60 different people all look like they came out of the same hand.
And it's important. It all helps the believability of the story, because you don't want the audience at any point during the story to be made aware of the fact that they're watching drawings. You just want them to believe that they are watching characters and that they become emotionally involved with these characters. And it's important to create a feeling of consistency throughout visually, so that suddenly you don't see six different Quasimodos in the movie, because I think that would kind of give away the illusion.
It is kind of ironic though that the best compliment that we've received is when people forgot that it was animation.
Yeah, mm-hmm.
Yeah, you know that we work for 3 years for 7 days a week, like 26 hours a day, making an animated feature, and the best compliment we can get is that people were so wrapped up in the characters and the story that they forgot that it was animated.
One of the stars of the show for me too is really Dave Getz. We've talked about him a lot through the commentary on the movie, but when you think about all the thought he put into using light and contrast to underline the contrast in the story,
that was something he was really key in and felt was crucial to the film, was echoing Hugo's themes of light and shadow and of contrasts between good and evil and differences in society. By exploring that idea through light and through color, he really put something special on the screen.
And Alan and Stephen too, Alan Menken and Stephen Schwartz, the ability to tell story in the context of a song is a gift that not too many songwriters have, and I think we were lucky in the end to have Alan and Stephen as our collaborators there.
Absolutely, and at least for our money, I think this is some of Alan's finest, most daring and boldest work that he's done for us yet, and I really don't think we can praise him enough for that.
That's certainly my favorite work he's ever done.
So as we come to a close here, we just tip our hat to the hundreds and hundreds of people that work together to make these movies. It's really a work of art, a great American art form.
I wish we could take the time to thank each and every one of them individually, but we'll just ask you to roll the credits about six more times and read every name carefully, because they deserve it. They all contributed.